I'd like to tell you how things are with me. I have to go back a way to do it. I was born in a very small town in Iowa, Cherokee, Iowa. Population 5,000 then. Well, that's a lie. Actually, there were only 3,000 people in the town, but the state insane asylum was on the hill. And it was civic pride that made us add the other 2,000 so that when you drive in, it would say 5,000. We were pretty well set there in Cherokee. My father was a minister. People used to say he only had to work one day a week, and he'd, you know, smile. But he wasn't Jewish or Catholic or Protestant, so everybody who wasn't anything came to our church. It was very crowded. And I figured that I'd follow in my father's footsteps. And I might have. Except one day a horrible thing happened. Some pitchman came into town who was an atheist, and he challenged anyone in the town to a debate as to the existence of the Almighty. Well, we'd never heard of anything like this. We stood there on Main Street like so many gaping Iowan idiots while this atheist was haranguing the crowd. No one would take his challenge. So finally, a quiet, meek voice from the back of the crowd said, "I'll debate with you." Imagine my surprise. It was my father. We all got together in the local gymnasium. I'll never forget it. The torches were flaring there on the wall. The American Legion band, all eight of us, playing something by Sousa, almost in tune. The first five rows was filled with older ladies of the Ladies' Aid Society, knitting for other pregnancies. And I listened to my father and this atheist on this stage in the ridiculous William Jennings Bryan Clarence Darrow bit. And I heard my father stumble over arguments that any child using only half his intelligence could answer. Like, what about Joan and the whale and that sort of thing? Because this atheist, with his shallow understanding, but his sparkling wit, somehow twisted my father around his finger. And when he left, the atheist laughing, he figured he had won the debate. My father got smaller and smaller through exit. Lost his job, left town and us. And that's the last we ever heard of him. That's his problem. The sins of the father are visited upon the son. I found that out from reading, and it's true. Do you know life for me in Cherokee from then on was a kind of torture? Children would throw gravel at my bedroom window of a Sunday morning, knowing I had no place to go. Members of the finger-pointing society would say, "There goes that son of a minister who left for Washington, D.C. And I couldn't get a legitimate job. So I had to leave Cherokee and I came to the big city. And I got my first legitimate job selling encyclopedias from door to door. I don't know if you know how it feels to have all the world's knowledge under both arms. Knock on someone's door and have a lady in pin curls come out with this kid screaming in the background, say thanks a lot but no thanks, and slam the door in your face. But my attitude was wrong, I guess. Something was wrong, because I lost that job, and I went down the ladder of employment until I reached the bottom. I was cleaning up in a pet shop, and I was happy. No responsibilities. I could go home and listen to anything. FM, I could stare at television. I could even work crossword puzzles without cheating. But even there, my attitude was wrong. I'll never forget, I was holding this Pekingese when it happened, that needed a bath so badly. and the woman was standing there chattering, and the smell of Chanel was waving across me, and something inside of me flipped. I became aggressive. I dropped that silly dog, and I said, I quit. And I walked out of that pet shop 4.5 stars above the sidewalk. And as I came closer and closer to the city, with the street lamps passing the retina of my new sensitivity like so many stationary stars in a constellation, I looked up, and there was a huge undulating halo over the entire city, going from oval to circle to oval to circle. And this halo was talking to me. It was saying, Ken, the trouble with you is you're different, and you want to be the same. I said, yes. Fortunately for me, just at that moment, three men were tormenting a young waitress. I went up and tormented her, too. They were so pleased with me that they invited me to go bowling. That's when I took my sensitivity and thought of the human bowling ball. With your own face or someone else's face on it, whether you're a sadist or a masochist, so when you hit, that strike would mean something. My necktie began to look like everyone else's necktie, and they admired my good taste. I was Democrat with Democrats, Republican with Republicans, Independent with the disinterested. I had discovered a great secret. That everyone loves themselves more than they love anybody else. And if I wanted them to love me, I'd better be like them. And it worked. This new philosophy, this sensitivity, brought me back up the ladder. Rung by rung, I made that Horatio Alger climb to the place called Pinnacle. And here I am. I can say with understandable pride that I'm the voice that says, poof, there goes perspiration.